dental hygiene is very important, and you know, it's nothing to be taken for granted.
It's packed.
I wish I'd been asked. Would you be willing to accept this large pile of money? Some fans slash friends for many years. Some people that started out as fans have become some of my best friends. I'm not going to give any names right now, but yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a weird distinction between fans and friends because, you know, I would like to think that my friends are also fans. I would think that they would not, you know, hang out with me thinking, oh yeah, I like him as a person, but I hate his music. Ah.
Thank you.
Question over here.
So I watched the show My Little Pony, and I know that you voiced a character called Cheese Sandwich on the show.
Oh, no.
I was wondering if you enjoyed playing a role on a children's show like that.
I did, yeah. I've done a lot of voiceover work and I do a lot of children's shows, and My Little Pony was something that I was very excited to do. Bill Anderson, who was on the road with me like in the early 80s, he went on to do a lot of the scoring for the My Little Pony show. I became sort of aware of My Little Pony through all the videos that the fans had done using my music videos and cutting in clips from the My Little Pony show. And they were amazing, they were really amazing. And then when they asked me to do a voice on the show, I jumped at the opportunity. An impressive percentage of the stuff I get asked to sign at this point is actually My Little Pony stuff. The fan base is incredible.
At what point outside of signing My Little Pony stuff did you realize, like, this is it, I've made it? Like, when, I mean, your career's really quite robust.
Yeah, I like to say when I appeared on The Simpsons, because that's sort of like my claim to immortality, you know. The Simpsons, you know, what are they in? The 5,000th episode now, and they'll be in syndication for the next million years, so. Actually, I've on the show twice. I'm one of a very small handful of celebrities that have appeared more than once on The Simpsons, so I feel it's an elite little group, and I'm very happy to be part of them.
I love that. Question over here.
Hi there, huge fan since I was a tiny little larva. First off, some of your older stuff, like Good Old Days. You know, you're kind of dark and had some pretty abrasive stuff to say, and it's gotten a little more mellow over the years. Was that just kind of how you matured, or was that a personal choice? And also, how do you keep your hair so amazing?
Well, those questions are related, actually. I've really mellowed. I mean, if you look, my stuff has always got kind of a dark streak to it. It's kind of a strange because my stuff is branded as family friendly, and I don't use profanity, and I don't generally do anything that's overtly sexual or really, you know, inappropriate. And yet, a lot of my songs are really dark. There's some really, you know, questionable areas. So that's just the way my brain works, and I can't really help it. And as far as my hair, you know, it just grows out of my head that way. I comb it sometimes.
Love you, man. Thank you.
Thank you.
Question over here.
I was just wondering what gave you idea to start up a band.
Well, I found that when I played the accordion by myself, nobody would come to my shows. Actually, it did start when I was a teenager. I tried to start my own band when I was like 13, 14 years old, and I found out that nobody wanted to play with an accordion player. None of the rock bands that I wanted to join, you know, felt a need for that. So it wasn't until I was in my 20s, after I had a hit with Another One Rides the Bus, and John Bermuda Schwartz, I met him that night, September 14th, 1980. And he banged on my accordion case live on the Dr. Romano show, and it became sort of a worldwide viral hit in the days before things went viral because there was no internet per se. And John and I just kind of looked at each other and said, well, we should put a band together. And we did, and we've had the same band since 1982. That I asked for permission for, I think When Doves Cry, 1999, Kiss, a couple others. Actually, the original idea in UHF, instead of Beverly Hillbillies Money for Nothing, it was gonna be Let's Go Crazy with Beverly Hillbillies. That was the original plan. And we pitched that, and he said, no, we went one with Dire Straits. But there were a number of times where, you know, we wanted to give it a shot, and for whatever reason, he always said no. So we, you know, I'd like to abide by the artist's wishes.
Fan.
Good job.
He's 33 and he still listens. I wanted to know, where do you come up with the idea with the song? Do you hear a song and it pops into your head, oh, I can do that?
For parodies, you know, I wish it were that easy. I mean, that's happened maybe once or twice where I'd be listening to the radio and I'd spontaneously get an idea. It happened that way with Fat. I was waiting for the new Michael Jackson video world premiere. And before the video was even over, while, you know, when they were going through the turnstiles in the subway, I was like, Fat, I gotta do Fat. And they'll be like, Fat.
Dr. Demento.
Yep. Okay. Yeah, Dr. Demento.
Go ahead.
So, what gave you the idea to start writing parodies for different songs?
You know, it's just something that I'd always done since I was a kid, I think. And I think most kids at some point do that. I mean, I didn't come up with that idea. I think everybody at some point in their lives hears something on the radio or starts making stupid lyrics. And that was something that I did as a kid, and I just kind of never grew out of that phase. And then when Dr. Demento came along, I said, well, why don't I send some of my stupid song parodies to the Dr. Demento show? And he played them on the radio, and that encouraged me to send in more, so I kept getting a constant stream of encouragement to the point where I'm still doing it.
I like it.
I get that question a lot. My stock answer is white and nerdy, because it's the most automatic. No real answer to that. I probably feel closer to the original songs because, you know, I wrote the music for those as well. I'm sort of partial to Jackson Park Express on the last album. It's sort of, you know, it's a deep cut, but it's something I put a lot of work into, and it's again very dark and twisted. But I really like the way that the production turned out on that. But it's, you know, I can't really give you an honest answer on that because, you know, I feel very close to everything I've ever done. It's a curse.
And there is your overdose of cuteness for the day. That is so cute.
And you know, everybody has to get a hug now to make it even.
Well played, it's like bingo. Now it's off the sheet, so nobody else can ask. Well done, sir, I admire your style.
In the Heights in Hamilton, you know, Lin-Manuel would come to my house every now and then, and we'd try to knock around ideas to try to write a musical together. And we actually, I don't think I can tell you too much about the story because I'm not sure how much of it is okay to say in public. But
do it!
I will not resort to pressure. But yeah, we actually were talking about, you know, doing a major project together, and then he got a little busy after Hamilton came out, so it might happen again sometime down the line. You know, we're still, you know, good friends and mutual fans, and we'd love to work together, but it might be a while.
That's a good question. Go ahead. Your turn. You can do it. It's tough, believe me.
they want me back to the dark side, I'd be happy to. That was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun to do. They had me do the, they affected my voice, and I was the, you know, the dark side voice, whatever that was. And they affected it, made it really scary. And then the joke being that, like, somebody offered me a cough drop, and I'm like, oh, this is much better. Thank you so much. but yeah, it was a lot of fun, and it's always fun to poke fun at yourself in a show like that. And yeah, I mean, I love the show, and I loved being on it. And if they wanted me back, I'd be happy to. I am 57 years old, and you?
7.
Okay. You're half a century older.
And go ahead, over on this side.
Hi.
Hello.
One of my first memories as a kid, like 4 years old, was Square One.
Oh yeah.
And you did a dreidel song parody. I can't find that anywhere.
Is a what song parody? A dreidel song parody?
Yeah, but it was like Patterns.
Oh, Patterns, yeah. I have to say, I did not write that song. That was actually written by a gentleman named David Yazbek, who is a really talented writer. He wrote... well, I don't. The character in the song hates weasels. And the song isn't even about... you know, hating weasels is just kind of a statement on tradition and that why you shouldn't do something just because, oh, we've always done it that way. And it's funny that, you know, not a lot of people, but some people really took me to task for Weasel Stomping Day. They thought, oh, that's animal cruelty. That's like it's just a song. No weasels are actually getting hurt. Do you eat hamburgers? I'm a vegetarian. Yeah, you know.
And question over here?
I have two questions. The first one, do you know what episodes you were in The Simpsons?
I do. There are Three Games in the Condo and That 90s Show.
I never won. What was it like working with all the like actors and actresses on Tacky? That music video?
That was amazing. I think that was the most fun I ever had on a video shoot. It was Jack Black, Aisha Tyler, Margaret Cho, Eric Stone Street, Kristen Schaal, and is that it? And me. And it was a lot of fun because I we did it all in one take. And we ran through it like six times. And by the sixth time, we were like, I think we got it, you know, I think we're done. But we have so much fun, I kind of wish that we were messing up more because I wanted to keep doing it because everybody was having such a good time. It was one of those kind of things where we rehearsed the camera move in the morning, and then they showed up at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and we were done by 4, and I was like, okay, goodbye, thanks guys.
Good question. Over here.
Hi. You were my first concert in 1983 at Summerfest.
I remember you.
Yeah. Back row. But anyway, I was a very weird child, and finding you and your music was really inspirational to me. So my question is, when you were in middle school, what song do you remember writing?
Writing?
Yeah.
In middle school?
Any parodies, or what was your first parody?
Okay. I mean, this is all stuff that I wish didn't get brought up, but since you brought it up, there are songs that were so bad that even Dr. Demento wouldn't play them. You know, I think the first parody that I sent him was a parody of Paul Simon "Loves Me Like a Rock," which was brilliantly retitled "Hit Me with a Rock," and it's about as clever as it sounds. But that's the thing about practicing and sticking to it, because over the years you get better. And I like to think that the stuff I did on my last album is a little better than the stuff I did on my first album, because you know, you got your Malcolm Gladwell 10,000 hours thing happening. You're like, you get better if you just keep at it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Question over here.
Why did you choose music as a career?
Well, I didn't think it would be my career, honestly. I went to college and got a degree in architecture because I didn't think I'd be a Weird Al for a living. I thought, this will be fun, but I didn't think that that's how, I didn't think I'd be here today, talking to you guys. And it was just one of those kind of things where I got a few lucky breaks, and my life, you know, went down this strange trajectory, and now I get to, you know, do exactly what I love doing for a living, which still kind of blows my mind. There are a lot of super fans here at the convention, I just try to treat everybody like my friend, like they're, you know, human beings, and I'm very thankful and grateful for, you know, any kind of positivity you want to put toward me. But you know, I'm just very, very thankful that they're here and that they show their appreciation. And thank you guys. Thank you.
Thanks for.
Oh gosh. Well, first of all, thank you so much. It's so wonderful to hear. It's just, you know. That's what you get for hanging around as long as I have. I mean, just the sheer tenacity of you know, if you can hang around and do something for, you know, several decades, you wind up, you know, affecting generations of people. And it's an incredible thing for me to hear that people have used my music for family bonding, you know, for, you know, I've heard that, you know, some people say that my music is a soundtrack to their life, or that they use it on long family trips. There's like a Weird Al Burlesque show where people are taking off their clothes to my music. And it affects a lot of different people in different ways. Is
that a Dante's here in town? I've got to go.
But that's very nice to hear. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And our last question over here to you.
A lot of pressure. Pressure.
My question was, so my favorite song is Amish Paradise, So why did you make this song and what inspired you?
Well, Coolio's song, Gangsta's Paradise, had been number one for a couple of weeks, and I was thinking, oh, I should do something with this song. And then I thought, you know, what would be like diametrically opposed to the gangsta lifestyle? The other end of the spectrum for that, well, Amish Paradise. Oh no, that's my next single, I gotta do this song. Because you think I'd be like excited and happy I came up with a good idea. It was sort of like, in that moment, I was like, my whole life has changed now. And the album's coming out, and I gotta go on tour. And like, it was like, I saw that all in an instant. But yeah, it was all that just, that epiphany, like, oh, I should do that, you know?
That was one of those songs that you mentioned. Now, you know what I do with this time I come down, I take a selfie with you, because it's a great perk of being here.